And now I'd like to introduce our the individual who will give the invited lecture this year, Professor Scott Gallimore. Scott is known to many of you because he's very active. In fact, having not seen his in Vitae before, I was impressed of all the things I didn't know that he had done in the past few years. It is impressive. He did his undergraduate work at the University of Toronto in classics and archaeology, and then he went on to the State University of New York at Buffalo, SUNY Buffalo, to do an MA, and then received his PhD there in 2011. Many people will know him from 2008 to 2010, as he was at the American School for 2 years as a regular fellow, and then as an associate, regular member, and then as an associate, member. He has participated in numerous excavation projects and surveys. He started out in Toronto in a historical archaeology project, and then in 2005-2009 he joined Yorgos Limonitakis and Vance Watras for the Galata survey project, being the Hellenistic Roman period specialist, which is his field. He then went on in between 2009 and 2010, as part of his stay at the American School, to work for 2 years at ancient Corinth on the excavations there, being an assistant field director in his final year. And then in 2010, through now, but not as an all in excavation, he was a key member of the Gornia excavation project led by Professor Vance Watras, SUNY of Buffalo, an American School project. In 2013, he joined the Sicyon excavation project of Yannis Lolas, University of Thessaly, being the Roman pottery specialist, and joining with Dimitri Nakasis, Sarah James, he formed the triumvirate that created the Western Archaeological Regional Project, which is now in its fifth year. This will be its fifth year of 3 years of survey. So his archaeological credentials are sound. In the meantime, in 2011, he was hired at Wilfrid, Laurier University in the Department of Archaeology and Heritage Studies as an assistant professor. And I think we'll have to stop the tape here because he has just been promoted to associate professor effective July 1st. He didn't hear that. We can't announce it until that date. But anyway, a very well-deserved achievement in his academic career. He has all of this field work and research has produced numerous publications. He turned his doctoral dissertation on Hellenistic and Roman pottery around the Arapatra, modern Arapatra Crete, into a book in 2015, part of the Lion Classical Studies series. He has a series of other publications. One of the things that interests me most, and something that I think more of us could have done, probably should have done, is that he has delved into the world of papyrology to be able to get a better idea of the study, for his study of Roman amphora in particular, so that he has published a number of articles relating to papyri and wine and amphora production. He has been working primarily on Crete. This is where his dissertation research was done, and that we see this in a Journal of Roman Archaeology article that will be forthcoming, dealing with the relationship between agro production and amphora manufacture in Roman Crete, in a World Archaeology article, two food surplus and archaeological proxies, a study from Roman Crete, the status of Romans held true, the traveler's accounts of the evidence for the formation processes at ancient era Pitina, a modern Arapatra in Crete, and of course he's part of the publication team for Gornia, and their reports are coming out in Hesperia. as well as the initial publications from the war. So that he has been very active. He has been covering a series of topics relating not just to pottery, but also the meaning that one can glean from this. So that what we have here is Scott is going to share with us his impressions on how Roman Crete came to be, what happened, where the Romans went right and the Cretans became Romans. So Scott, would you please come to the podium, and why don't we
especially since I am still, I think, fairly new into my academic career, but it is great to be here and to see everyone kind of brave the range I've been hearing kind of in the back, pounding down over the past little while. Now, tonight, what I want to do is talk about Roman Crete, thinking about the early history of the island under the Romans. So, focusing not just on the conquest by the Romans, but looking at a couple centuries after that as well, and thinking about some of the processes, the stimuli that may have led to the island becoming what we would refer to as Roman. Now here, this is just to provide a little geographic context, because of course, Crete under Roman rule is not exactly what people often study, although interestingly, there are a few beyond just me, even in the room tonight. Of course, it's an island much better known for its Bronze Age history, for the palaces, and even kind of into the Iron Age as well. And I just put up some of the more well-known Roman sites here, Gorton being starred because it was the capital of the province under Roman rule. Now, I will say our knowledge, our understanding of most of these sites is fragmentary, to say the least, and we do have kind of limited data for a lot of different topics we might be excited to study, but I don't think that should prevent us from trying to explore a variety of different topics and think about what was going on during this period when the island joined an international empire, one that stretched across three continents, with Crete perfectly positioned to support exchange of ideas and economic commodities across a wide variety of areas. So we'll be looking at a few different areas tonight, but just kind of keep a couple of those sites in mind. Now, if we are going to talk about the formation of Roman Crete, we probably do need to look at the conquest of the island by Quintus Caecilius Metellus from 69 to 67 BC. Now, we are told in the sources that this was a brutal conquest, and in fact, even at one point, the Cretan forces sent envoys to Pompey the Great, who was also engaged in battles within the Eastern Mediterranean, saying that we will surrender to you if you just get Metellus to stop. We will hand the island over. Pompey said, that's great, let's do it. He sent his envoys back with them, and Metellus attacked all of them, kind of a mini civil war, a preview for what was going to happen within Rome. But this is one of the questions that's come about, is how significant an event is this for thinking about the creation of Roman Crete? In the seminal work on Roman Crete, a book by that very title by Ian Sanders, in the opening page, he says that starting his study in 67 is a decision that requires no historical justification, that the island has been conquered, now I can launch in my discussion, although there has been some debate after that, because this conquest does not really mark an abrupt end to the Hellenistic period on the island at a number of different sites. And in fact, other arguments have been raised that maybe 27 BC, which is when we have the first attested reference to the joint province of Crete and Cyrenaica, a region in North Africa, arising, and it seems to be an important date possibly for the foundation of a Roman colony at Knossos as well. And this is actually something which is true of a lot of different regions in the Eastern Mediterranean. At what point do you switch from calling a place Hellenistic and start calling it Roman? And Crete, as we're going to see, is particularly problematic in that regard. Now, if we're going to start with the conquest, we should realize that, in fact, 69 was not the first time that the Romans attempted to invade Crete. In fact, an invading force had arrived on the island shores a few years prior to that, in 72. Now, the person who led this attack, Marcus Antonius, is probably better known for being the father of Mark Antony, Julius Caesar's second-in-command. In fact, after his devastating loss in this war, he was granted the name Creticus, kind of the Cretan conqueror, as an insult to an extent for how badly he had failed in this regard. Now, this is interesting for a number of different reasons, because prior to 72, Roman interactions with Crete had been relatively neutral, if not positive. We have early evidence going back into the early 2nd century where Rome was getting involved in Cretan affairs. They were often acting as an arbitrary with treaty negotiations between hostile city-states, even in one case between the city-states of Herapetna and Aetinos, which apparently lasted for about 50 years, so it took a long time for them to negotiate. So what changed? Why suddenly in 72 do you see a naval force kind of bearing down on you that requires some type of response? Well, it turns out there might be a few different reasons why Roman opinions of Crete turned hostile. And if we look at Marcus Antonius's campaign, he had been granted Imperium Infinitum to attack the island. Now, Imperium was the Roman concept for granting the power to command an army to a general. Infinitum, I mean, infinite power, seems kind of a bit odd from a Roman perspective, especially during the Republic, but it's a geographic designation. Typically, a Roman general was given a very specific region into which he could take his army, but if you're dealing with a maritime conflict, and specifically, that was a designation used for generals who were dealing with piracy, which could spread across a wide region, you didn't need the same geographic boundaries. When Pompey swept through the Mediterranean a couple years later, in 3 months, wiping out piracy from the west to the east, he had that same designation. So the fact that someone was given a mandate to stop pirates and they launched themselves at Crete is probably telling. And in fact, during the Telesus campaign, one of the first sites that he destroyed in the western part of the island, Thalassarna, excavated by Elpida Hajidaki in the 1980s, she's argued that that was a pirate haven, a pirate harbor, and that was one of the reasons it was under direct assault, kind of a direct target of Metellus. Now, there might be a couple of other things going on as well, beyond the fact that the literary sources do tell us Crete was a haven for pirates, along with Cilicia in southern Asia Minor, but it might not have been the only reason. In fact, this coin here provides some intriguing evidence, where it was issued at Fortin soon after Metellus' victory. He issued it to tetradrachm. It's only a few, maybe a half dozen examples that are known, but it might also point to another reason. And we can actually associate it with Metellus because there's, on the obverse, there's a bust of the goddess Roma, the big ears and the trunk. We have an elephant, and it turns out one of Metellus' ancestors did defeat elephants in a battle in North Africa, so he's honoring his ancestors. But the puzzling part is the image in the middle, Artemis Ephesus. And this is puzzling because there's no evidence for the worship of Artemis Ephesus on Crete. Artemis was a very important deity, but not this manifestation. So why would this be the image of choice? Well, it turns out, 20 years prior to Metellus' victory, many Cretan cities had sided with Mithridates of Pontus in his war against the Romans. And that war in 88 BC had included the massacre, as the sources tell us, of 80,000 Romans at the city of Ephesus. And the Romans, after that, had sought to take revenge almost on everyone who had supported Mithridates. And in fact, that even included Sulla's invasion of Athens in 86 as another supporter. And one argument by Nikos Metanides is that this coin, that image, it brings a symbolic end to the Mithridatic War, that Crete was one of the last places that Rome actually needed to take vengeance against. Maybe that wasn't the primary reason, but clearly it was in the back of the mind of people like Metellus that finally we can put all of that to rest. And then there's the other standard argument of imperialism, that Rome just liked to conquer stuff, and Crete was one of the last places in the Eastern Mediterranean unconquered, so, well, let's fill in the blank in that regard. And maybe there's some truth to that, but there are other kind of reasons we can consider. Now, one thing this tells us, though, because, of course, the Cretans defeated Antonius in 72, although one thing it's important to specify is we're not talking about a unified Cretan force. There was kind of a naval contingent led by a man named Lasthenes who associated with Cydonia and Knossos. It may have, in fact, been a fairly limited part of the island that engaged in that battle, but, of course, it had repercussions for the entire island. Now, I bring up these passages from Jan Driessen, who was working on sites like Akrotiri on the island of Thera, because clearly we have invasions that are 3 years apart. The Cretans had to expect that the Romans were going to come back. And what would that mean for the archaeology of the island? Are we going to see an island that becomes unified, that builds up its fortifications, that is in preparation for an attack, not going about just a regular daily business, and are surprised a second time when this naval force comes sailing at them? Well, it turns out the Cretans were worried enough about this that most of the cities sent envoys to Rome to plead to the Senate. You beat Rome in war, and somehow you're going to the Senate to ask them to spare you to an extent, because Rome, unlike most societies at the time, could hold a grudge almost like any other. Now, these envoys, it turns out, were initially successful. The Senate was willing to hear their pleas. They were coming up with negotiations. They were going to come to an agreement where Rome was not going to conquer Crete. They were going to essentially become allied to the Senate, to the city, until this man stepped in, Lentulus Spinther. He was a tribune of the plebs in the Roman Senate, and that position gave him veto power over any decision of the Senate, and he vetoed the motion. And in its place, he proposed one where Crete had to surrender every ship that it had, hand over 300 hostages, give over the war criminal Lasthenes, and pay a fine equivalent to 4,000 talents, which all of the eastern provinces combined would go on to pay an annual tribute of 8,000 talents. So this was, there are some scholars who have argued that this demonstrates the economic prosperity of the island, although it was probably set to be so high that they had no choice but to refuse, which gave the excuse for the next invasion to come. So again, they would have seen it coming to an extent. Although again, what does that mean from a crisis standpoint? Well, if we just go back to this map, illustrated by Ian Sanders, kind of looking at the 3 years of the conquest, we can see, in fact, that we might not be looking at a unified Cretan force all standing together to fight against the invaders. I mean, we can see Philastronaut isn't listed here, but it is actually just over here. It was devastated. Interestingly enough, Polyrrhenia here is labeled as a site that's attacked, and while that may have been the case, it's also a site, if it was attacked, it surrendered quickly, because we have a statue dedication to Caecilius Metellus that's been found at the site. There's in fact a good chance that they welcomed him in because they were enemies of Cydonia, and if he was going to fight Cydonia, they were going to be on his side. Gordon had surrendered even before Metellus arrived, so he ignored them, and this is why they became the capital of the province afterwards, whereas other cities fared much worse. But because it wasn't a unified effort to combat against this invasion, it's not that surprising that really after Crete was conquered, we have no indication whatsoever of resistance. They hadn't been unified in that regard to begin with, which is somewhat of a characteristic of the Hellenistic period on the island, and now they're under control. But again, what does that mean? Can we simply say now we have Roman Crete because it's been conquered, because 67, they're under the political authority of the Roman Senate? And what does this mean for material culture? Because I will say evidence for this war directly in the archaeological record is limited. Philastroma has the most comprehensive assemblages. We have the destruction of the shrine of Glaucus at Knossos, which probably dates to this event. I encountered some destruction deposits at Arapetna that probably deal with the final siege at that particular site, but we actually don't have that much evidence, but we also don't have a lot of published excavation data from those periods from sites on the island. Now, I will say, one way we could examine this is just by looking at one very quick case study of how the material culture looks kind of after Metellus's attack. I will say, using a single site on Crete as a case study is going to be misleading. I will warn you about that, and we'll come back to why that is in just a little bit. But I think the unexplored mansion here, kind of the ironically named at this point, unexplored mansion, dug by the British from 1967 to 68, and then again from 71 to 73, it's a significant excavation in the history of archaeology on Crete because there are very important Bronze Age remains there, but the archaeologists at the time decided to actually treat the post-Minoan remains as kind of equal to that earlier history, to not just kind of dive through them and kind of as an obstacle to get to the Bronze Age architecture, but to actually give them a systematic treatment. And this is well published in a 1992 volume edited by Sackett. Now this is intriguing because when you look at the pottery section of that volume, in this case some of the Hellenistic deposits, so they are labeled as being Hellenistic, age 32 through 37, in some cases here we have deposits that were created up to two decades after the conquest and they are being labeled Hellenistic by the excavators. This is where you find them in the publication. And in this case, it's because when you look at the pottery, all of the material in those assemblages, none of it looks any different from what was going on prior to 67. It's the same shapes, it's the same range of forms, it's the same fabrics, it's an identical assemblage from before and after, which means the only reason they would have to term it Roman would be the date. And in this case, to keep things consistent, they kept it on the Hellenistic side, but of course, this is what's caused archaeologists in some cases to be reticent to really commit to 67 as that solid date when Crete becomes Roman. And in many ways, this is asking about the significance of a historical event and how it correlates to material culture and transformation. And those are ideas we're going to talk about as well tonight. And as for the first Roman deposits, A1 and A2, the reason that they are Roman and not Hellenistic is because of one artifact each, which we're looking at here, an amphora and a figurine, and it's because the fabric, the clay that these vessels were made of, clearly came from the Campanian region of Italy. They are imports coming from the West, and not just from the West, but from Italy itself, and that was deemed justifiable to switch it to the Roman period in this case. And then afterwards, we do see more and more imports, whether it's Italian sigillata, Eastern sigillata A, Cypriot sigillata, confirmed within those deposits as well. But I will say, there's no shortage of disagreement when it comes to defining the Roman period on Crete, where this is a sample of 10 survey projects, and not surprisingly, not a single one of them agrees with another one, where they have a variety of start dates, 150 BC being the earliest for just the Roman. You can go earlier if you combine everything. I like this, where almost the same, but not quite, the first year of the last year of the conquest, and then the division between early and late, or even in some cases kind of adding a middle Roman in there. I mean, how do you study a period when it's almost impossible to synthesize data in this particular circumstance, where no one can seem to agree, what do we mean by Roman? Now, I'm actually a guilty party on this list, I will admit. That's me right there. So I knew full well that I was not going to be able to agree with anyone, and I actually followed some advice from Susan Alcock in her book Reichia Capta when I came up with that date range, but it was the 10th date range that was different. And not to just put Crete on the spot, but I will say I've made charts like this for mainland Greece as well, and they're no better. Every project, it's kind of a fate of the Roman period that no one can seem to figure out what exactly we mean, when does it start, when does it break from early to late, when does it end? But of course, that does cause us some issues. Clearly, there's a lot of different discussion, a lot of ideas. When did Roman Crete actually begin? Now, there's a lot of ways we could perhaps look at this perspective, and scholars have approached this topic from a number of different perspectives, and I'm going to try a couple of other ones tonight. Now, in this case, this particular idea here, eventful sociology, where we're going to talk about how it relates to archaeology in just a second, this was a study by a scholar at the University of Chicago, Sewell, he was a historian who had spent his entire career in departments like sociology and political science. And one thing that he had come to realize is that historians, and we can say archaeologists in that regard as well, had a much better command of long-term ideas than a lot of the other social sciences, but they did not have the same development when it came to theory. And he was trying to combine these two ideas, that history especially was often punctuated by significant events. It was a diachronic narrative. But what do we mean by a significant event? How do we interpret it? What specifically about an event could lead to social transformation or perhaps not lead to social transformation? He was concerned with the idea that for an event to be significant, we would have to have a society where essentially elements of it became disarticulated and then perhaps rearticulated in some novel way. That could be positive, it could be negative, it could be neutral, but he was trying to look at it from that perspective. Now, one of the key ideas for archaeology here, I've always thought, is that it requires you to understand a society before that event as much as you do after. Whereas in a lot of events, whether they're disasters, which we often focus on, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, floods, fires, or what have you, that destruction deposit can be so kind of distracting that it's very easy to kind of focus more on the aftermath rather than thinking coherently about what was going on before. Now, this has been adopted into archaeology. There's an article in Current Anthropology from 2007, and then in 2008, there was a conference at the University of Buffalo dedicated to this subject, and I helped to organize the conference, which is why this has been on my mind for the past decade. In fact, Douglas Bollinger is an Icelandic archaeologist. This conference brought together scholars from a global perspective, ranging from the Paleolithic up until the 19th century AD, although it did include a couple of classical papers, including one on Pompeii, probably not surprisingly. And again, one of the reasons why this had an appeal to archaeology is when Sewell was looking at kind of the idea of social transformation and how you study it in a society, he realized that objects inherently have a lot of ties to society. He was basing a lot of his ideas on the concept of materiality, that with material culture, you can gain insight into the cultural, the social, religious ideals of a particular group, which means the material culture can help us decipher when or when there may not be a transformation going on. Now, this is how he figured an event would have an impact, where you're looking at a society, and in this case, societies are fluid, where they're not necessarily at any point in equilibrium, which means it might just take a gentle nudge for things to start transitioning. And again, it doesn't have to be negative. One of the issues of kind of thinking about events in a discipline like archaeology is we do tend to focus on the bad stuff, the volcanic eruptions, the earthquakes, the battles, the disasters, the rapid onset events. We don't often think about the slow onset ones, the ones that are difficult to recognize in the archaeological record that may in fact have a degree of significance. So here, he uses the term structures. I will say, because he is approaching it from sociology, they love jargon more so than archaeologists, and it's tough to actually wade through that sometimes. Whether you want to use structures or institutions, there's a lot of them, they tend to intersect. The union of those structures can change only as much as you want. Talking about resources as well, and anything that might cause a disruption to any of those categories, not necessarily all of them, might result in that transformation. And again, he in his jargon kind of laden description, an event would be something that causes a rearticulation. If it doesn't, he called it a happening, kind of introducing even more terms to this type of idea. Now, before we get to Crete, though, there has been a previous study that looked at this approach within the western provinces of the Roman Empire, specifically looking at areas of Spain and even parts of Italy that came under Roman control. And in this case, Spain became a Roman province as we were entering into the 2nd century BC as a result of the Second Punic War. And that conflict is much better known for Hannibal's invasion of Italy, but it also involved Roman forces attacking and destroying a significant number of sites in Spain that had sided with the Carthaginians. In the aftermath, Spain was organized into two provinces under Roman control. And in a lot of those sites, such as this example here, recently published in the Journal of Roman Archaeology, we have distinct evidence for destruction. We have weaponry, we have fire deposits. In this particular case, there's also evidence for the Roman camp right outside the walls of the city, so you can almost track what was going on. But one thing the scholar in question who did this study, using an eventful perspective, Luis Ravel, who actually has a chapter in that volume we were just talking about, she noted that afterwards, as we enter the early 2nd century, throughout the 2nd century, into the 1st century BC, nothing really seems to change. The architecture in these cities, when they rebuild, kind of maintains the traditions from before. The pottery maintains the traditions from before. Again, we don't have a lot of evidence for transformation if we're looking at it from the perspective of material culture. This, in fact, is not uncommon when we're thinking about the Romans, especially during the Republic. They often did kind of leave things at the status quo after they've added a region to their growing empire as a way both of appeasing the population, but they were also trying to adapt their own government structures to really figure out how to deal with this growing empire. They had unexpectedly conquered the island of Sicily. How their first conquest was essentially by accident is one of the kind of the things that really spurred on the Romans, but it meant they really had to learn on the fly, how do we govern regions outside of peninsular Italy? Now eventually, of course, things do change, because if you visit Spain, you can visit a lot of ruins that do have that Roman character, where we see the amphitheaters, we see the stadia, we see the fora, we see the infrastructure projects, the aqueducts, the roads, kind of all of these elements where if we were in class, we'd probably be doing a Roman archaeology class or something like that. So what happened? What was it that finally spurred a lot of these transformations? And Ravel has argued it was actually the rise of the Emperor Augustus. So in many ways, kind of 27 BC might become significant, but Augustus, when he came to power, sought much more unification across the empire, including promoting a state religion, the imperial cult, thinking about kind of the architecture, promoting the construction of things like aqueducts, of road systems, refurbishment of cities, so that it would be a more coherent empire. Of course, he focused a lot of his attention on Rome, but we have building projects in a number of different regions as well, particularly in the west, maybe not as much in the east, but that's not a disaster, depending on your opinion of Augustus. But one thing it does show, again, it's more slow onset. It's not something where you could just say, well, he came to an agreement of the Senate and everything changed. It was a process he was undergoing from a social perspective, religious, architectural, a wide variety of elements. Now, what does this mean for a study of Roman Crete? And again, thinking about the conquest and why nothing seems to change. Well, one thing, especially looking further afield, we realize Crete is not an anomaly. In fact, it fits a much more standard picture that we don't really have much evidence for transformation after conquest during the period of the Republic. Now, one perspective that's been used to discuss a lot of kind of this slower change that we see on Crete is globalization, which Rebecca Sweetman has talked about in a number of papers. Globalization being the idea that geographic restrictions on social and cultural institutions begin to recede, and the people realize that they're receding between a number of different areas. Now, one thing that becomes apparent that Sweetman has pointed out on Crete is that we actually get a very different picture between the northern part of the island and the southern part. So sites like Knossos, for instance, we really don't see much evidence for transformation into the late 1st century BC, into the first half of the 1st century AD. It's almost into the latter part of the 1st century AD, into the 2nd century, when we really start to see a lot of these other elements. And Knossos has always been a surprise in that regard because it was a Roman colony. You would expect more Latin, you would expect more Roman-style architecture, and they seem to almost have been resisting against it. We get a very different picture at sites in the southern coast, though. Maybe not surprisingly, Gorton, who surrendered quickly, who became kind of the favorite of Metellus, who became the capital of the joint province of Crete and Cyrenaica, they start adopting kind of housing forms, architecture, other types of styles fairly quickly into the kind of after conquest. So we get a bit of a disparity between what you see in the archaeological record in the south and in the north, although by the late 1st century AD, the early 2nd century, they've started to come together, where we have a more coherent, comprehensive picture across the island. And in those cases, arguments have been you're seeing more investment from the Roman government, you're seeing the benefits of exchange networks that have really come to thrive across Crete, between Crete and a number of regions in the Mediterranean. And those are actually two ideas that I find very intriguing, to an extent because I study the economic history of Crete largely through pottery and other means, is, well, how can we actually focus in on those ideas of investment and trade routes and the impact they may have had on an island like this? Because what finally did spur sites like Knossos to kind of start joining up with Gorton, where we do get a more consistent picture by the second century? And I think looking at economic aspects may be another way of approaching this topic. Now in this case, this map is meant to illustrate a facet of the Hellenistic economy of Crete, which there are different opinions about what was going on then. Angelos Haniotis has argued that Crete essentially did not have many external connections, that its production was for the level of subsistence, they weren't sending a lot of goods out of the island, even if they were bringing a few in. Natalia Bokakoff-Brogan has argued that, in fact, Crete's economy was much more robust in this period, and that we simply haven't identified enough evidence to really come up with a definitive picture. And I like to be the stereotypical Canadian in this regard and go right down the middle of those two and say, well, maybe it's somewhere in between. Now in this case, the map we're looking at is that we do have evidence that Crete was involved in exchange networks even under kind of the Hellenistic period. And data from Harappadna on the southeast coast, the modern day city of Harappadra, is telling in this regard because Hellenistic pottery there has a higher proportion of imports that you see at other sites on the island, such as Knossos, and primarily those imports come from southwestern Asia Minor and islands like Rhodes and Kos. And so they're sweeping in. Interestingly enough, those are the types of finds that dominate at sites like Alexandria as well. Now, where this is intriguing is at Alexandria, six stamped amphora handles have been found that come from Harappadna. It was the only site that apparently stamped their amphorae during this period. Now, I admit, six pieces of pottery compared to the tens of thousands that have come from Rhodes does not speak to a robust export industry, but it does suggest that ships were, even if they could bypass it and head straight down, in many cases, they were stopping over in a site like Harappadna before continuing their journey to Egypt, and every so often, something from Crete seems to have made it onto one of those ships. Now, this is important because a lot of Cretan cities like Harappadna do appear to be prosperous during the Hellenistic period, and where is that coming from? Where is this prosperity actually deriving from if they're not shipping a lot of goods out? Well, Crete is great in the Hellenistic period. It preserves more treaties between city-states than almost any other region beyond Athens. And one thing that happens in those treaties very often is there's specifications that if cities are trading goods over land, they are exempt from taxes. If they trade them by sea, they are subject to customs dues and the collection of them. And that would be true for external ships as well. Every time one of these boats stopped at Harappadna, and Harappadna in the late Hellenistic period controlled a territory of about 1,000 square kilometers along the south and the north coast, including most of the harbors in that regard, they could collect all of the necessary customs. We have evidence for this in papyrus texts from Egypt. We have an important inscription from Ephesus that details this in the Roman period. They were probably bringing in quite a lot of resources simply by taxing the ships that came into the harbor, benefiting from their position on these various trade routes. And even after the island was conquered, some of the evidence that starts to filter into our ceramic assemblages may point to this picture as well, where Eastern Sigillata A, a fineware manufactured in the region of Antioch beginning in the 2nd century BC, here we're looking at some fragments of some large plates or platters that primarily date to the 1st century BC, and they become common at sites like Arapahoe, like Gorton, like Knossos. There was an argument by Lionel Caslin that after Crete was added to the Roman Empire, grain ships coming from the Levant in Egypt were now able to bypass roads, which had never been a favorite of the Romans, and could sail by Crete instead. And again, we have some evidence here, kind of the proxy data suggesting there are kind of goods flowing in from those more eastern regions. And if these ports are again collecting these customs dues, they are building up resources in this regard, capital to an extent. And in this regard, again, kind of thinking about it from an economic perspective, this is another way we could view it. This is something known as resilience theory, which is being borrowed in this case from the field of ecology. And it's becoming increasingly popular with archaeologists, particularly those working in Aegean prehistory. And the idea here, it's a counter to the traditional model that things go well, then something happens and everything collapses. The idea that even if something bad does happen, eventually we see a reorganization. It can be on different time scales. Oftentimes you can have nested examples of this model going where we can talk about the entire island and then regions and then cities and then rural areas all operating in conjunction as different areas are prospering, kind of heading through the front part of the cycle, where this in many ways is a transformation itself. I apologize that I keep doing that. Where we can see essentially what happens in that phase is you're building up your natural capital. You're getting to the point where, in fact, you have built up your connectedness. You are, in many ways, becoming less resilient, but it's a slower process, perhaps, of actually getting to the point where, how is it that Crete eventually came to be one of the dominant forces within the Roman economy, just based on how much product they were sending out, and how far afield do we find it? In this case, when I mean building up capital, collecting resources from customs dues, survey archaeology does show us that, for instance, the Galatas survey and the Kavusi survey in northeastern Crete, massive olive production centers that pop up in the early Roman period. The Galatas survey in central Crete, massive wine production that springs up. We see evidence in the Mesra, they're building up that infrastructure. Amphora production, the number of kiln sites in the Hellenistic period jumps from about 7 to over 20 between late Hellenistic and early Roman. They're building up the capacity to ship these goods out. And in many ways, what we could ask then is, what is the tipping point? Kind of, is this just gradual? What actually spurs a lot of that economic connectivity to finally be realized for the island like this? And in this case, there's an interesting argument by a scholar who worked at Carthage, Stephanie Martin Pilcher, who said that when you really start to see Cretan amphorae, which are our best proxy evidence for the economic connections of the island, is in the second quarter of the 1st century AD. They pop up at Carthage then, and in fact, this really does seem to be, kind of, you see the dam break at that particular point. By the middle of the 1st century, around AD 50, we have Cretan amphorae in notable quantities in Britain. We have them in almost every region. At Rome, between 50 and 60 AD, 7% of all of the wine amphorae that are attested come from Crete. By the late 1st century, that number jumps to 12%, and by the middle of the 2nd century AD, Crete controls 20% of the wine market at the largest city in the empire. An excavation at the early 2000s at Monte Testaccio, the famous amphora dump in Rome, produced over 40,000 fragments of Cretan amphorae in a very small area. Kind of massive amounts of products are flowing out. But what is it about the second quarter of the 1st century where that starts. What again, was it just a built up enough capital and suddenly it spilled over and the market was flooded with Cretan passoon, the raisin wine for which they were famous? What was going on in this regard? And again, thinking about, well, if this was when a lot of these connections built up in Crete really began incorporating itself into these economic networks, it might help explain why we do see kind of more and more presence of these other characteristics as we head into the later part of the century, into the second, because of course trade, that itinerant population, all of these merchants bringing their religious beliefs, different ideas, their architectural innovations will become much more predominant on the island. And in fact, one of the big things that happens here is during that period, Crete becomes linked to the Alexandrian grain fleet, where everywhere the grain fleet goes, Cretan amphorae are found. So in the latter part of the first century, the most common site to find a Cretan amphorae would be Pompeii and Puteoli in the Bay of Naples, and in the second century, it's Rome. And that's not just because sites like Pompeii are destroyed, it's because in the first century, Puteoli was the primary harbor of Rome, where they'd take the ships there, load the cargo on smaller ships, and send them up to the Tiber. And by the second century, Portus at the mouth of the Tiber had taken over, and we can see Cretan amphorae kind of following in that direction, because they're probably piggybacking on these Alexandrian ships. Now, what is it about the second quarter of the first century that might be significant in this regard? Well, it turns out, and I realize this is a bit, try and pretend that's Claudius and not Nero in this regard. I did this because this point of Nero shows the harbor of Portus, but one of the things that the Emperor Claudius did when he came to power in 41 AD is he initiated a massive infrastructure project across the empire focused on harbor improvement and construction. Now, it appears Claudius was concerned that there were too many shipwrecks, too many cargoes being lost because there were not enough sufficient harbors around the coastal regions of the Mediterranean. So he sought to improve this, where, for instance, he initiated massive construction at Portus, right across from Ostia, which Nero actually finished and apparently took credit for. He did this in other sites, at Lechion, for instance, major harbor construction in AD 45. We see it at Caesarea. We see it across the empire. In fact, there's an interesting argument where the number of shipwrecks in the Mediterranean starts to drop off quite a bit in the first century AD into the second century, and maybe rather than being an indication that trade is in decline, it's that Claudius' actions actually worked, that maybe there were more opportunities if you were foundering, you could find a safe haven before shipping off somewhere else. Now this is intriguing because even though our dates for the Roman harbor construction on Crete are basically non-existent at this point, dating a single one is a bit of a trick. To wrap it now, there is an article from 1923 in German that does argue that the large double harbor of Rapitna was built by Claudius. Now, there's not much evidence to back that on, but again, if this harbor construction at sites like Rapitna and perhaps ports like Kisimos and Chersonesos, if we are looking into that early period when this type of thing was going on, and Claudius, we do have a lot of Claudian inscriptions, kind of boundary inscriptions around Rapitna, perhaps supporting that he was active, or at least his officials were active in that area. All of that natural capital that had built up, suddenly there were the means to support larger ships, to support more ships, to become even more integrated into these exchange networks, for which Crete was perfectly positioned to transship goods coming from the Aegean, coming from North Africa, coming from the Levant, and coming from the West. It sits right in the middle of that nexus in the Eastern Mediterranean, and now it had that potential to build on that. And in many ways, that's why we get a diagram like this, where what this is meant to represent is all of the sites in the Roman Empire where evidence of Cretan amphorae have been found, dating to this period. And in many ways, perhaps, it would be better to do it from the mid-first to the second century, but there are 144 dots on this map, and I can tell you it's nowhere near comprehensive. There's a lot of other places. Now, prior to in the second quarter of the first century, there were some Cretan goods trickling out as well. We get finds at Leptis Magna and Berenike in North Africa, at Pompeii and Ostia, in the La Crescenta 8 shipwreck near France, but this is when we see a lot that we're at Pompeii, we have over 500 complete examples of Cretan amphorae. Veronique, we have a few hundred. We have many at Athens. We have thousands of them at Rome, where we see that connectivity. And I realize I'm kind of looking further afield in this regard, but again, it's an island that could support trade from almost every direction because it was the place you could stop. And in fact, we even see, for instance, Paul in the book of Acts, when he's trying to sail to Italy, he is on an Alexandrian grain ship that is sailing along the south coast of Crete. It's during the winter months, so when they try to get to one of the harbors, they're blown off course and wind up shipwrecked on Malta, but it's an interesting kind of correlate for what was probably going on regularly at that time. Now I will say, just coming back kind of at the end to this point raised at the beginning, I do think that the conquest of Crete is significant for defining when we should really start talking about Roman Crete. In this sense, Ian Sanders, when he made that statement, he was setting a very nice historical event for kind of from a political perspective. Now that might not have a lot of significance in the archaeological record. We might not see much information for transformation. But again, this is one of the tricks, especially when you're doing historical period archaeology within the Mediterranean, that those historical events often will not correlate with change in the archaeological record. The death of Alexander the Great does not cause massive change in a lot of different areas, and we see this as well. And again, one thing, actually at Tristan Carter's lecture on Monday, he made a very good point about insular archaeology, the idea that, you know, when you're studying the islands, you can kind of look inward and forget to look outward. This is something which impacts Crete in every period of its study, but we have to remember it became part of an empire that controlled territory in three continents, and that when we do look at other examples, especially around this period, it isn't an anomaly where Rome was conquering, and then, especially in the latter part of the first century, they had a lot of other things to worry about, like all the civil wars that they were fighting, but they hadn't really developed strategies at that point for all of that direct integration that we see with later acquisitions, such as Britain, for instance, in 43 AD, which has a very rapid transformation, but that comes during a different period of its history. And I think maybe looking at it from that economic perspective, we can again start to build on these pictures of how is it an island starts to transform, how a lot of these ideas come in based on these longer term processes rather than a single rapid onset event. And thank you very much for your attention.